So it's my pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker for the summit. I hope you're all as excited as I am to hear about this. So Ben Westhoff is an award-winning investigative reporter whose books are taught around the country and have been translated around the world, including Fentanyl, Inc., How Rogue Chemists Created the Deadliest Wave of the Opioid Epidemic. The bombshell first book about the fentanyl epidemic published. He's advised officials at the top levels of government about the opioid crisis and been interviewed as an expert commentator in the New York Times, on CNN, NPR, and C-SPAN, and on full dedicated episodes of Fresh Air and the Joe Rogan Experience. His new book, Little Brother, concerns his cold case investigation of the murder of his little brother in the Big Brothers Big Sisters program, and his previous book, Original Gangstas, is the definitive work on West Coast hip-hop, so a nice variety there. He has also written for The Atlantic, The Wall Street Journal, Rolling Stone, and The Guardian. Please welcome Ben Westhoff.
Thank you, Tristan, and thank you to DPHE for having me. I wrote it on my hand. I was worried I would get the acronym wrong. Sounds like you guys are doing some incredible work. I was so impressed to hear about all these programs that you're putting in place. So it is really a pleasure to be here among all of these people who know so much about this field and this problem. And I live in St. Louis, which is an interesting part of the country. It's right on the Mississippi River. And when it comes to the fentanyl crisis, it's largely geographic in its effects. So the problem, as most of you know, started in the East Coast and has been coming west very quickly and now has really arrived in the West in a big way. And I have spent the last couple months actually touring different big cities in the Western U.S. I was in Seattle, San Francisco, L.A., San Francisco, San Diego, and now here in Denver, and really trying to get a sense of the problem on the ground and speaking with public health administrators, users, law enforcement, all sorts of people. So my first awareness of fentanyl came when a close friend of mine died in 2010. His name was Michael Schaefermeyer. He was a DJ, and he started getting prescribed OxyContin after he had a bad car accident, and that kind of spiraled, and he started misusing fentanyl patches, and he also had a problem with alcohol, and the night he died, he had patches on, he was drinking, and he passed out face down in his pillow and basically suffocated. And, you know, since then, that was my first time hearing of fentanyl, and we all know the numbers and how bad it's gotten since then. Largely, the narrative around fentanyl so far has been as an adulterant, and the death of Michael K. Williams, for example, he was believed, I think, to have used cocaine adulterated with fentanyl. And we've heard so much about the adulteration of meth and heroin and pills, of course. Fentanyl was invented in 1959 by the Belgian chemist Paul Janssen, who was trying to find a good alternative to morphine, which was the reigning analgesic of its time. And fentanyl really fit the bill. It came on more quickly, it kind of faded away more quickly, and it caused less nausea. So for procedures like open heart surgery, it was really a revelation. But the problem is that for the same reason it's good as a medical drug, it's bad as a drug of abuse. It comes on quickly and fades away quickly meaning that users, when they're addicted, have to re-up over and over again, you know, whereas with heroin, you have a long, you know, might not need to re-up for the whole day. With fentanyl, it's just every couple hours. From a manufacturer and distributor point of view, fentanyl was also something of a revelation because, of course, heroin comes from a natural plant, the poppy, which takes a lot of resources and time to grow and is also very susceptible to law enforcement. And what you have now is a drug that's made in a lab, and it's, you know, what they say, 50 times more powerful than heroin. So when we look at how the problem has evolved, when we go back to 2017, you'll see that it's mostly clustered fentanyl overdose deaths in the Northeast, the Midwest to some extent, and the Southeast. But if we fast forward a few years, you can see that now here in the West, the overdose rates are climbing the fastest for the most part. A big reason for why this trend is evolving the way it is has to do with what type of heroin you get in what type of what part of the country. And so east of the Mississippi, it's mostly white powder heroin, which can be credibly mixed with fentanyl. And so fentanyl, you know, can also be mixed in with cocaine pretty easily. A white powder can be pressed into pills. But the root of the problem, it really began in a big way with heroin adulterating, fentanyl adulterating heroin. And so west of the Mississippi, you mostly have black tar heroin. And so fentanyl can't be credibly mixed with that. I was just on Skid Row in LA a couple days ago, and they're selling pretty much fentanyl as fentanyl. And so this represents kind of a sea change, I think, in the way that we're going to be thinking about fentanyl going forward, and the public health outreach has to be tailored to match. So in Skid Row, just a couple years ago, crack cocaine, heroin, these drugs were really prevalent for sale. But now it's almost all just fentanyl and meth. And as we know, this is a very rare sort of moment in the history of drug abuse in America when it comes to deaths, because usually we have a wave of stimulant deaths followed by a wave of depressant deaths. So usually cocaine deaths are rising and then maybe opioid deaths not as much, or vice versa. But now we've got the case where stimulant deaths and opioid deaths are rising at the same time. And a lot of that has to do with fentanyl adulterating meth, adulterating cocaine. But what we're seeing increasingly is that users know that they're getting fentanyl. And so we're seeing this in Denver. You know, we've had a lot of people talking about the intersection of homelessness, mental health problems, drug abuse here in Denver. The rising drug deaths. I don't need to tell anyone in this room that fentanyl deaths are rising. So when it comes to the pills, this has been sort of one of the biggest problems on the West Coast. We've seen these M30s, they're called. And what these are oxycodone pills. What these are intended to replicate are oxycodone pills manufactured by Mallinckrodt Pharmaceuticals. And so they hail from the great city of St. Louis, Mallinckrodt. And while Purdue Pharma has gotten most of the blame when it comes to who we're blaming for the opioid crisis, Mallinckrodt Pharmaceuticals actually probably deserves just as much blame, if not more, for making, you know, hundreds and hundreds of millions of these pills. And the marketing tactics were equally nefarious. There was a salesman who was caught on tape saying something like, talking to a distributor or a rep saying something like, you know, just keep making them. They're like Doritos. They'll keep taking them. We'll keep making more. And so in the illicit market, these M30s have kind of been like the big blockbuster illicit pill of the last few years. And some people call them the blues. Basically, they are cut with fentanyl. And for a long time, a lot of people really didn't know that, especially young people. They would be given one of these pills at a party and think it was a legitimate pharmaceutical and overdose and die. And this has been an awful story that's really been happening for years now. But that is starting to change. And you've probably heard a lot recently about these Skittles, you know, rainbow M30 pills that we're starting to see now. And so this represents a couple different things. First of all, it represents the fact that I think the wool is not being pulled over people's eyes as much anymore, or it's not attempting to be. You know, I think most people, when they see these pills, they realize these are not pharmaceutical-grade pills that someone was prescribed by a doctor. There's been a lot of talk about if the cartels, the Mexican cartels that are making these pills, are trying to advertise them to children. And, you know, I don't know the answer to that question exactly. It seems kind of dubious that they would be trying to market to young kids who aren't big opioid users at all. But I think it's just more of a case of branding. They had these blockbuster, the blues, and now this is a way to kind of differentiate their product. When I was in San Francisco, they were selling powdered fentanyl, also in these kind of rainbow colors. And it's actually made by using fondant powder, which is what's used in wedding cakes. And so they're dyeing the powder. Powdered fentanyl is mostly what's being sold on the streets of San Francisco. And from what I understand, it's a form of branding. And, you know, a different dealer might say, well, I've got the green, and that's the strongest. Or I've got the orange, and that's the strongest. Although from the DEA analysis, it seems like they all pretty much have the same levels of fentanyl in them. So I don't know if anyone's been to San Francisco lately, but I used to live there for about 4 years between 1999 and 2003, and I actually used to come to UN Plaza, this area, and play chess. You know, there were these sort of standalone chess tables set up, and a lot of homeless guys would play there, and you could bet like a dollar, and I would usually get beaten pretty badly. But the area has really dramatically changed since I was there. And I'm sure you've heard a lot about the open air drug markets in the Tenderloin. And it really spills down by where they have the BART stations at Civic Center. And then it spills down into the South of Market District. And so this is really like nothing I've ever seen before, that people are buying, selling, and using right out in public. And again, it's a situation where it's fentanyl being sold as fentanyl, and everybody knows exactly what they're getting and exactly what they're buying. To get a sense of where this is going, we might look to the city of Vancouver. And Canada is really interesting because while in the US, like I mentioned, the epidemic has gone from east to west. In Canada, it's been the opposite, and the epidemic has gone from west to east. And so in Vancouver, it was around 2017 that they started selling on the street these combinations that were called down. And so this was kind of the first indication that people weren't being fooled anymore. There was briefly a time when heroin was being sold as heroin even though fentanyl was cut into it. But very quickly, everybody knew that this wasn't pure heroin. They started calling it down. But now, and for the last couple of years, that's totally changed. It's fentanyl. It's being sold as fentanyl. And of course, that doesn't mean it's pure fentanyl. There's lots of indications up and down the West Coast that fentanyl is now being cut with benzos, with benzodiazepines, like analogs of Xanax and Valium, things like that. But again, it's a situation where nobody's under any illusions. So what I was interested in doing as a journalist was tracking how these drugs get into this country. And so we all know about Mexico as the supplier of most of the hard drugs in the United States for a number of years now. Cocaine is produced primarily in Colombia, but it's trafficked through Mexico. Meth, for the last 17 years or so, has been made in Mexico, trafficked up here. Heroin, the heroin we use in the U.S., has long been trafficked from Mexico. And fentanyl is the latest sort of major drug of abuse that the cartels are very much involved in. And there was a recent Wall Street Journal story which had these incredible pictures of this sort of clandestine fentanyl lab. And what I've been hearing lately is that whereas before the trend was mostly these labs in these really rural areas, you know, away from law enforcement, away from big cities, that now the cartels are starting to move into urban centers and they're setting up in apartments, building these sort of more sophisticated labs. And there's also been some indications that during COVID, when the supply chain from China was cut in a big way, that more Mexican chemists were being recruited by the cartels. I don't know if recruited is the right word exactly, to make fentanyl. And there is some indication of that. But primarily, the cartels are still using the precursor chemicals from China. And so a fentanyl precursor is basically the most important chemical component. It's like the main ingredient. And once the cartels have the precursors, they're about maybe 90% of the way there and can produce the finished fentanyl, which they ship across the border. And so back when I started looking into this issue, there was really no reporting had been done at all about China and its role as a producer of fentanyl and fentanyl precursors. So back then, it was very easy to find these different labs. All you had to do was just Google buy fentanyl in China. This was around 2017. And all these different chemical companies would come up. And to some extent, that's still the case today. If you can find fentanyl precursors really easily for sale on these B2B sites, like this one called Chemical Book. And this is reflected kind of in the evolution of the legality of fentanyl in China. And so back in 2017, fentanyl itself wasn't legal, but all the fentanyl analogs were. And so you've heard about these fentanyl analogs that they basically can have the same effect as the same mode of action as fentanyl, sometimes even stronger. It's just that a tiny bit of the chemical equation has been changed. The chemical structure has been altered. So what these chemists would do in China is that once one fentanyl analog was banned, they would just slightly tweak the chemical structure so that now you have something that's almost identical, but it's completely legal. In the U.S., we have the Federal Analog Act, which means that if two drugs are the same in terms of their action or very similar in their chemical structure, they're automatically banned. But in China, they don't have anything like that, which means that each new analog has to be banned one by one by one by one by one. And so it's this constant cat and mouse game. And this isn't just true with fentanyl, but it's true with all these other drugs of abuse, like synthetic cannabinoids, often known as K2 and spice. That's what we've seen the most derivatives of. You know, for most of human history, there was only a handful or two of drugs that were regularly used as drugs of abuse, and those were, you know, largely came from plants. But in recent years, we have years where there's like 100 new chemicals for recreational use, 150, 200. And a lot of these are the synthetic cannabinoids. So I wanted to know more about this world. And so the first thing I did was make a fake Skype profile under my drug dealer alter ego, Johnny Webster. And I tried to imagine what a drug dealer might look like. And for some reason, I came up with this guy. And it was very easy to contact these different chemical companies in China. Like I said, their web pages were just right there on the clear web. And so all the salespeople just had their Skype addresses right there, their emails, everything. And so I just started contacting a bunch of different ones on Skype. And as you can see from my list of contacts on the left, a lot of these companies also sold steroids. And so anabolic steroids, like fentanyl at the time, were both sort of these gray market drugs that were legal in China but banned in the West. And so that's what these companies specialized in. This guy calling himself Sean Steroid Hormone, you know, was not really being too subtle. So I kept chatting with these salespeople, and eventually I was like, you know, if I came to China, would you be able to show me your lab? And a number of them said, yeah. And so at the beginning of 2018, I found myself on a plane to China. And this was a decision my wife wasn't super thrilled with. And looking back now, I still think it was very reckless, and I can't believe I did it. But I was comforted by the fact that these aren't like the Mexican cartels. A lot of these people I was dealing with were like super kind of nerdy, stereotypical science types, and they were really concerned with following the law. And so they don't have guns, there aren't like beheadings, things like that. And so basically I thought I would give it a go. I actually first talked with a traditional sort of street level drug dealer, and this guy on the left, and we had some hot pot, that's his girlfriend on the right, and we met outside Shanghai. And I wanted to know, you know, I was like, China drug penalties are so severe. I mean, you can get life in prison for something like 2 grams of drugs. They, you know, the state, you know, gives the death penalty to drug dealers frequently. And I was like, you know, how do you deal with that on a day-to-day basis? And what this guy told me was that Chinese law enforcement is very selective in who they're pursuing. China has its own drug problems among its population. So they have a big problem with meth, they have a big problem with heroin, they have a big problem with ketamine too. But when it comes to these new drugs, the NPS, novel psychoactive substances, like fentanyl, they don't really have an issue at all. And so this guy was dealing NPS. He was dealing these kind of new types of LSD known as N-bombs, which is just has to be the worst name of a drug ever. But basically, it's a kind of new psychedelic that wasn't banned in China at the time. And he said he sort of just rested easy because the government, the police tend to operate on crackdowns in China, is what I was told, that there wasn't sort of the systematic enforcement of all the laws on the books as much as there would be a directive, like now we're cracking down on meth, and so it's an all hands on deck sort of situation with law enforcement. So after that, I went in pursuit of this guy on the right, whose name was Dowson Lee, and I had been chatting with him on Skype. He owned a lab that was making NPS in Shanghai, and he struck me as different than a lot of the salespeople who I'd been speaking with, because he was a chemist and a salesperson. But he also wasn't trying to, you know, he wasn't being too aggressive. He was answering my questions. I would take these conversations in a lot of different directions. You know, I would ask, what's the price, you know, et cetera. But then I would be like, well, how'd you get into this business? You know, tell me about yourself, your background. And he was very, very patient. And I asked him if he would meet me when I came to Shanghai, and he said yes. And when I arrived, I met a translator. My translator's name was Jada. She was from China, but was living in Amsterdam. And so she was kind of going to be my eyes on the situation, in addition to her translating skills. So Dowson wanted to meet me at a metro stop in Shanghai. And so I had the understanding that we were going to walk to his lab from the train station. And so Jada was kind of lurking in the background about 25 feet away, keeping an eye on us. But then when Dowson arrived, he sort of whisked me away in his car and we drove off. And so I lost my point of contact. And not only that, but I didn't have my actual cell phone, because in China you have to like rent a cell phone and you have to register it with the government. And so it was literally like one of those old flip phones, and the GPS was not working. So I found myself heading out into the great unknown. And we actually first went to his apartment, and this is the apartment he shared with his wife in this kind of gated community in the penthouse level. And he had me take my shoes off. He offered me a glass of hot water. It was the middle of winter, and it was pretty cold, and most houses didn't have heating. So I was offered this hot water a lot, and I like didn't drink it, though. I was worried it might be drugged or something, which was probably a smart thing to do. But he handed me this printout with all of the different NPS, the novel psychoactive substances that his company was selling. And they ran the gamut from different, opioids, different synthetic cannabinoids, different synthetic cathinones, you know, different hallucinogenics, all sorts of things. And I asked about the prices. And then he basically asked me, he was like, well, how do I know I can trust you? How do I know you're not a journalist? And so I was like, oh, okay. And I sort of nervously laughed, and I was like, oh, that's a good one. That's a good one. I made up this sort of long, convoluted story about how I wasn't actually a drug dealer, but my friend was a drug dealer, and that he was interested in forging a long-term relationship with a Chinese supplier. And so I wanted to see his lab, and if the lab had met our quality standards, then we would place a big order. And so he still wasn't sure what to think about me. We went to lunch after that. We had this long lunch. He started, you know, becoming more comfortable. And finally he said, well, I trust you. And he called up his driver, who came and picked us up. And so his driver was kind of this like beefy guy who didn't speak any English. And I was worried that, you know, this was like the muscle of the organization. And I really, and then we headed off into the kind of deep Shanghai suburbs. And we arrived, he wouldn't let me take any pictures or anything. We arrived at this sort of office park, the kind, you know, it looked just like a suburban office park. So there was like the mechanical arm, he put his fob at the parking gate, and the arm went up. We went inside. It was kind of a new construction building that was completely anonymous looking from the outside. And we went upstairs. There was like a floor of some salespeople. And then we went up another floor, and there were the labs. And the kind of first thing it immediately reminded me of was just my high school chemistry class. It was like the black lab tables, the Bunsen burners, the glassware. The smell was really overpowering. Like I said, it was the middle of winter, but they had all the windows up. And he put his shirt over his nose, and I did the same thing. And there were signs posted like everyone must have appropriate, you know, masks and eyewear, but most people didn't. It was actually a pretty small lab. There were about five or six different rooms and maybe five different employees, but there were, you know, these big round glassware that was synthesizing these fentanyl analogs and also these synthetic cannabinoids. And I had my phone with my recorder on sort of smuggled in my jacket pocket and listened, you know, I asked all these questions just to get him to really explain what everything was. And kind of the most shocking part was this one of these black lab tables that had this big pile of these cannabinoids that were drying out. And it was just this insanely big pile of drugs. And then right next to it were all these kilo bags that were tied up and getting ready for shipment. And he listed off all the countries where they were sending them to, Russia, Europe, the U.S. And he said that he made a really strong effort to follow the laws of the countries where he was sending them. And he said, you know, is this type of fentanyl? He said, this is going to the U.S. Is this legal in the U.S.? And I said, well, no, none of them are. So I don't think he really cared about that much. But he clearly did care about the laws in China. And he said that one of the fentanyl analogs actually he thought was going to be banned soon, so they were going to toss out the whole batch. So, you know, and China actually did blanket ban all fentanyl analogs in 2019, about a year after I was there. And so that was all very interesting. And then my next stop was Wuhan. So again, this was 2018, before the pandemic. So I knew just about nothing about Wuhan. And it turns out that before COVID, it was kind of best known as a chemical industry center and also known for having all these great universities. So there's kind of a pipeline of chemistry graduates who go into the industry there. And it's the vast majority of it is legal industry, above board industry, and you know, just a small portion is dedicated to these gray markets. But China is the biggest chemical and pharmaceutical industries in the world. They don't make a lot of the most famous brand name pharmaceuticals. So in terms of the revenues, the US is more, but in terms of the pure volume, China makes almost all of the generics, you know, stuff like vitamin C, acetaminophen, all these products. And so there's kind of a lot of room for this rogue gray market industry to be operating within this above board industry. And you hear a lot about at night, these companies that are making legal products use the same equipment basically to make this other stuff that's being illicitly exported to the US. So this time I was hoping to meet this guy whose name is Ye Xuan Fa. And this is a picture of him from probably the early 90s when he was younger. And this guy came to become my nemesis of sorts for reasons that I will lay out. But he owned a company that was called the Yuan Cheng Chemical Company. And so I'd been doing as much research as I could before I left about companies making fentanyl precursors. And so when I typed into Google, buy fentanyl precursors, there are all sorts of different companies that came up, you know, dozens and dozens. But the more I investigated them, the more I realized that almost all of them went back to this one company, that they were shell companies of this guy's main company. And this is their operations. This is actually an old hotel where it turns out not only do they have their sales force there, their company headquarters, but the employees actually live in that hotel too. And it was not hard for me to find because they put their address right on their webpage. And I was in touch actually with that guy, Sean Steroid Hormone. And I said, you know, I'd love to come to your headquarters and, you know, look into buying some of your products. And so when I showed up at this place, he wasn't there, and I was texting him, and he said, well, I'm actually in another city, but my colleague will meet you. Her name is Amy. And so I met Amy in this lobby, and she was, I'll show you a picture. She's the one to my right. And she also arrived with another colleague who also introduced herself as Amy. And it turns out they were longtime friends who went to college together, and they were both working for the company for about 3 years, and they were actually roommates in this hotel. And they all lived in these kind of dormitory style apartments with maybe 5 or 6 people. And that was part of their contract, was that they, you know, it might sound a little bit kind of like a company store to us, but a lot of these young college graduates saw it as an incentive, you know, free room and board. I'll show you later, but they have their own company chef. And so so they were very friendly. They were sort of flattering me, and they were, you know, just salespeople to the hilt. And I asked them about these fentanyl precursors, and they said, yeah, we can sell those to you. I asked about some steroids, things like that. And then after that, I kind of just pretended to be a dumb American, and I asked for a tour of the facilities. And I was taking pictures the whole time, and, you know, I think they just thought I was just a dumb American. And so this was the sales floor, and I was really shocked to see just how vast this was. There were probably 200, maybe 250 salespeople working in these cubicles, and almost all of them were recent college, as far as I could tell, were recent college graduates and picked for their English abilities. And so they operated on, like I said, Skype, social media. They, you know, it was very modern organization, and this company, Yuan Chung, ostensibly offered over 10,000 different chemicals. And so you could buy anything from like rubber accelerants, all these weird industrial chemicals, to like knockoff Viagra, to like steroids and fentanyl precursors. And it turns out that those were sort of their main products that they were selling. And so after that, they actually showed me some pictures. You know, they went to great lengths to explain that these are all legal chemicals in China, blah, blah, blah. But they showed me pictures of how they package up these precursors to send them overseas. And there's all this fake packaging, like this one's for bread with wheat flour. And then they have this like dog food packaging. They had this like banana snacks, all sorts of stuff. So it was very clear that they knew what they were doing. And they also talked about in customs, they said, we have our own people in customs on both the American and the Chinese side that will help get the product through. And, you know, they also showed me the canteen where everybody took their meals, and on the walls there were like pictures from team building exercises and all sorts of stuff like that. And then, as I mentioned before, I saw the company chef, and he was chopping up some meat for lunch that day. And you know, in its own way, it was sort of like a mini Google campus where you just like never have to leave the building to get everything. And so after I got this tour, we went upstairs to, and there was another, you know, set of cubicles, and sitting at one of them was the guy I came to meet, the CEO, Ye Xuan Fa. And that's him in that picture. That's what he looked like in 2018. And so I was shocked to see him just sitting there at another cubicle and kind of dressed, you know, kind of dressed down. Everyone said I read a newspaper article about him that said, if he was with his driver, you wouldn't be able to tell who was the CEO and who was the driver. And he was also purportedly the richest man in Wuhan at one point, one of his salespeople told me. And so he didn't speak any English at all, and I don't speak any Mandarin at all. And the Amy's sort of translated our conversation for a while, but that petered out fairly quickly. And so it wasn't until I got home to the U.S. that I called him with a proper translator, with Jada on the line, and really, you know, asked him the hard questions about how can you justify selling all these fentanyl precursor ingredients that is being turned into fentanyl that is causing this horrible crisis in the U.S. And basically his answer was that, you know, these are chemical intermediaries. These aren't drugs. You know, we don't know what people use these for. They're legal in China. And so, you know, it's really out of my hands. And I talked to, you know, chemists who told me that that's really not true at all, that these precursors have pretty much one use and one use only, is to make fentanyl. And that's since changed, as some of the precursors have been banned. Now there are precursors, which can be used for more things. But in any case, I put all this information in my book, Fentanyl Inc., which came out in 2019. And it also talked about how the Chinese government was actually subsidizing these companies like his, like this exact company. They give all this like research and development money for, they give awards. This was like a very well-respected, decorated company that got all sorts of subsidies from the government. His daughter, Ye Xuan Fa's daughter, is a Communist Party member. I don't know if they were kind of pulling the wool over the eyes of the provincial leaders too, who, you know, saying we make these above board products when really they were specializing in these precursors and steroids. But whatever the case, I published all this, and then I sort of waited, and I was waiting, you know, to see what would happen. Oh, I forgot this. When I was walking out, this was a sign advertising the company, and I thought it was kind of ironic. Chemicals create a better life. And then as a parting gift, the Amy's gave me these nougat candies, this bag of these nougat candies, and I did try those, and they were very good. So like I said, the book came out in 2019. I went and I testified on Capitol Hill. I was sort of like thinking this was going to cause action. But for years, nothing happened at all. I didn't like hear anything more about this guy until December of 2021, when an indictment was unsealed and he was indicted for distributing fentanyl precursors, resulting in all sorts of deaths in a bunch of different states. There was a $5 million reward placed for information relating to his capture. And it turns out that the DEA had been kind of conducting an investigation at the same time I was. And not only that, but the U.S. Attorney's Office executed a seizure warrant for an online wallet containing $2.3 million worth of Bitcoin that was traced to his daughter. And this was presumably used to distribute fentanyl precursors. And so his name in this document is Chen Yip Fat, which is the Cantonese way of saying Ye Xuan Fa, so it's the same guy. So a guy I knew put together this sort of flow chart about this whole family, which explains his relationship to his children and also to all these different shell companies. So like I said, there was, it was like all these different companies were doing the same thing. And then after my book came out, the main company, Yuan Chung's, or their website went down, they sort of disappeared, but these other shell companies were still operating. And then I sort of started learning more and more about his daughter. And her name is I don't know how to pronounce that very well at all. But she also went by Amy Yip, another Amy, different Amy. And on her LinkedIn page, of all places, she has herself as the managing director of a pair of these different shell companies. And so, Ye Xuan Fa, the CEO, is kind of getting up there. And so it seemed to me that he was grooming his children, particularly his daughter, to take over his empire. But then I found her Instagram page, and she presents herself kind of as like an influencer of sorts. She did nothing about drugs or chemical companies at all, but she has all these pictures of her sort of globe-trotting adventures to, art galleries and shopping. And she soon actually scrubbed her LinkedIn page of those mentions of those chemical companies and listed all this other stuff she's been involved in. Like, she was in a movie, she's done modeling, she has this jewelry designing business too. And it turns out she got a degree in jewelry design from a college in Australia. And I even went so far as like track down a gallery in Hong Kong where she was selling her stuff. And this Bitcoin wallet that had $2.3 million worth of Bitcoin in it, she claimed was actually not related to fentanyl products, but these were the proceeds from her jewelry designing business, which is not credible. I think she had one piece for sale at this gallery. So then after that, I heard again from the CEO, Ye Xuan Fa, and he submitted to the North Texas District Court, who had filed the indictment against him, this declaration. And basically, he blamed the indictment, the $5 million reward that was offered. He blamed everything on me. And he said that I had mischaracterized him. And he questioned my credentials. He said, was he a journalist or a businessman? He was reporting as business for US Coca-Cola and Pepsi, or a secret agent who worked for the US government. So let me break this down a little. First of all, I'm not a secret agent for the US government, but could I tell you if I was anyway? But in terms of Pepsi and Coke, his company made this preservative for colas, and they had this like their biggest product according to them, and they believe that Coke and Pepsi stole it from them and that I somehow facilitated this. And so I think basically he was trying to save face in China through this declaration. The bottom line is, though, he has never been arrested in China, and there's no extradition treaty. And so basically he can, nothing is gonna happen to him unless maybe he takes a flight to the US or one of our ally countries and is arrested when he gets off the plane. But that seems really unlikely, especially now that the indictment has been unsealed. In fact, off the record, the the attorney's office told me that they were kind of giving up, and that's why they unsealed it, because now he knows, you know, what's happening. So like I said, in 2019, all the fentanyl analogs were banned, and we did actually see a drop in seizures of fentanyl analogs since then. And so that would seem to be like a good thing, right? Unfortunately, the result has been these companies have shifted to other chemicals that they're making. And so, like I said, these companies really try to follow the law. And so what we started seeing soon after were seizures of this new drug most people hadn't heard of called ISO. And ISO's specific properties were that it's an opioid, but it's not a fentanyl. And so technically it's not covered by these new laws. And so we saw that. And then even more prevalent, we've seen all these kind of novel benzodiazepines knockoff analog benzos. And so these are like similar structures to Xanax and Valium. And as I mentioned earlier, we're seeing benzos all over the place. In fact, I think it might represent the next big U.S. drug of abuse crisis. Not only are we seeing benzos cut with fentanyl, but we're seeing fentanyl cut with benzos. And I think the reason for that is that whatever drug is being sold the most cheaply is going to be the adulterating agent. And these companies in China, it's like a bidding war, or it's like an arms race. Just throw all those metaphors away. But basically, the prices are going down and down. And it's, to me, a direct result of the ban of these analogs, as these companies are now selling all these benzos. And again, it's just a game of whack-a-mole. And the other thing these companies continue to sell are the fentanyl precursors. And again, whenever one gets banned, another one is sold. And now we're seeing a lot of precursors. So all of this basically led me to the conclusion that we are not going to stop these drugs from coming into the country. In fact, every time the numbers may dip from China, you might start hearing about more of these synthetic drugs being imported from places like India. And so there's really no stopping them. And it just led me to believe that we can only control what's happening here in the U.S. and, you know, on the ground, the exact kind of stuff that DPHE is doing, trying to, you know, distribute naloxone. And, you know, opioid use disorder medications, everyone knows about these. People know that they're still not being offered to everyone who needs them. I don't need to tell you about the benefits. But sort of the most distressing part to me was this article just came out the other day. And, nearly 50% of Arizona eighth graders have never heard of deadly drug fentanyl. And so I'd love to see more of these surveys around the country. And it's clear that the numbers are just startlingly low. And an education campaign is like, I think to a lot of policy experts, like people in this room, fentanyl is just so obvious, so obviously the problem, that it might not even occur to us that lots of people out there, especially lots of young people, have never even heard of it. And I think we need to really focus our efforts in this way. So my voice is starting to give out. It's a good thing I'm at the end here. That is it. Thanks, everyone. I'll take some questions, and be sure to stick around for the meditation. All right, thank you.
I wanted to ask about your process when you were outside of the country and interacting with these people. What kind of danger were you constantly in involving the law enforcement there? Like, could this have gone really south if you got caught in the same room with these people doing your investigations?
Yeah, that's a good question. I actually was more worried about the government than I was about the drug dealers in terms of I went in there on a regular visa, just a regular tourist visa. And so I'd been told by other journalists that if I got an official journalist visa, that I'd sort of be, they'd assign a babysitter to me who would tell me where I could and couldn't go. And I knew I wouldn't be able to go to labs and stuff like that. But also I knew that I could get in a lot of trouble for not having the proper visa. And so in terms of these dealers themselves, I mean, I think they really were trying to stay quiet, you know, even though the drugs they were selling were legal ostensibly. The government, you know, can change the laws at any time, and they don't want companies that are out there giving China a bad name. And so I think they had an incentive to keep things quiet. But in terms of me spreading this information that makes China look bad, I was worried about that aspect of it. But thankfully, it went off.
All right. Another question. I don't remember if you said it or not, but how long were you out there?
I was there about 2 weeks.
You kind of are a secret agent, man. But all right, thank you.
All right, well, thank you.